Two rounds, independent firing. At 300 yards, ready!
In the previous video, part one of the series, we examined the trip itinerary, as well as presented an overview of the clothing, kit, and weapon of the British infantry in 1879.
This video, to enable a better understanding of how the army operated in this era, will consist of a short introduction to the organization, formations, maneuver, and tactics of the army as used in the 1870s.
As is so often with military history, much of the detail regarding accounts of battle is anecdotal. Quotes like, "they fought them to a standstill," or "they fought until they were overrun," sound dramatic, of course, and can certainly paint a mental picture of proceedings. But what is often lacking in all but the most discerning work is detail relating to the tactical disposition of the soldiers, and how their training in drill, both personal and collective, translated into formations used during the battle, as well as how their rifles and the musketry training associated with them resulted in different types of fire and subsequent effect on the battlefield. As this series on my trip to South Africa grows, I thought it prudent to explain some fundamental details of army training, with a view to the infantry in particular, to better frame any subsequent discussion of the three battles this series will deal with. Isandlwana, Rorke's Drift, and Spion Kop.
The army operated under what was known as the regimental system. The regiment was the soldier's cultural home. He wore its uniform, which differed in detail from regiment to regiment, and fixed its peculiar badges to it. He learned of, and indeed may have contributed to the building of its history. And perhaps most interestingly, he was keenly aware that his particular regiment was different, and based on solid, soldierly logic, better than any other.
The regiment was the man's clan, tribe, and in many cases, his family within the army.
In the era of the Zulu War, regiments were numbered in seniority from when they had been raised in antiquity. Famously, the regiment that provided the majority of the infantry fighting at Isandlwana and Rorke's Drift was the 24th Foot.
But the regiment was not a field or fighting organization. That role was filled by the battalion. By 1879, the first 25 regiments each had two battalions, with the remaining junior regiments having one, with some exceptions. The battalion was the operational and tactical building block of the army. This was the fighting entity. Typical of the regiments with two battalions, one of them would be posted abroad, while the other at home. Famously, yet uncharacteristically, both battalions of the 24th would see service in South Africa at the same time. At full strength, numbering some 800 to 900 men, it was nominally divided into eight companies, along with other subunits, such as the Corps of Drums, the Band, and a small section of Pioneers. As well, there was a small selection of senior ranks who looked after the administration of the battalion. The whole was commanded by a lieutenant colonel. His fighting subunits, the eight companies, were each commanded by a captain, with two lieutenants to assist. The company was divided into two halves, nominally each under the command of one of the lieutenants. These half-companies, or divisions as they were sometimes known,
were again broken in half, forming two sections, each under the command of a sergeant. Thus, in the company, four sections were present, each of around 20 men. The senior sergeant was appointed the color sergeant and did duty as what would now, in the modern context, be the company sergeant major, the company quartermaster, and he also managed the men's pay. The company really was the man's home, both in barracks and the field. He drilled in its ranks, and he shot with it at the range. And typically, it was the smallest unit that would be given a specific task on the battlefield. Although the company was the maneuver unit, the section was typically the fire unit, with the orders to fire and cease fire being given by its NCO commanders. This, of course, did not preclude, in the perfect world, fire directed at the company or even battalion level.
The document that governed the drill, tactics, and maneuver of the infantry in the era of the Zulu War was the 1877 Field Exercise and Evolutions of Infantry. This mouthful of a title was augmented by another volume, the Musketry Regulations. While the former gave direction for individual or squad drill, as it was known, as well as company, battalion, and brigade movements and tactics, the latter, the musketry regulation, gave direction for the use of the rifle of the day, the Martini Henry. In this were a series of instructions that detailed how the rifle was to be carried, both in formal or ceremonial circumstances, as well as in the field. These were collectively known as the rifle exercises. This also gave instruction on how the rifle was to be fired, both in the context of individual marksmanship, as well as its collective use and application of its fire. This was known as the firing exercise.
Fire volley at 200 yards, ready! Present! Shoulder! Arm!
With this basic understanding of the organization of the infantry, we can now examine some tactical considerations and what they look like. The battalion would generally use one of three close order formations for movement or initial stages of an attack or defense. These were the column, the line, and movement in fours. The column and the line were true battalion formations, while the latter, movement in fours, was more of a technique for movement of companies within the battalion framework. The column formation consisted of each company in line, but with the eight companies arranged one behind the other at varying distances, all of which were based on the company's frontage. The default distance was a space equal to the frontage of the company, while half and quarter distance referred to fractions of that distance between companies. The line formation consisted of the companies in line, but one beside the other. This was the fighting formation of old, and was used at Waterloo, Elma, and so on. For both these formations, the men were formed in two ranks. For rapid movement in fours, the two ranks were reformed to four, and typically the men turned to a flank before marching away. This allowed for more space between the men, and thus easier maneuver. It was, however, not a fighting formation. With these formations in mind, it's necessary to understand the types of spacing, or dressing, used in these formations. Close order saw the men shoulder to shoulder, and the ranks one pace apart. Open order had the same shoulder dressing, while the rear rank was placed three paces apart from the front. This was an administrative or ceremonial formation, as the officers stood at the front versus the rear, as in close order, and the space between the ranks allowed for movement between them for inspections and other administration. The third type of spacing was extended order. This saw the ranks at close order, but rather than standing shoulder to shoulder, The files, consisting of the front and rear rank man, were spaced with any number of paces between them. By 1877, this had become the primary fighting formation, and the drill for its use would have been known to all. Movement in extended order was done with the files formed, that is, with the rear rank man behind the front. Fighting, that is to say firing in extended order, was done in what was known as rank entire, or a single rank, with the rear rank man moving up to the left of his front rank man. Thus, every weapon could be used and local cover could be capitalized upon by every man. Extended order for skirmishing was quite a flexible arrangement as to cover and fire position, while extended order for the attack, and to some degree for the defense, was somewhat more formal, with designated intervals of 4 paces. As mentioned, the tactics as used by the army were laid out in the Field Exercise and Evolutions of Infantry. The 1877 version reflected considerable tactical improvements over previous versions. The 1870s marked a major evolutionary step in the development of infantry tactics, specifically the aftermath of the Franco-Prussian War, with its use of breech-loading rifles on both sides, saw thoughts put towards necessary reductions in the density of formations while in the face of the enemy. Not only were dense formations vulnerable to the greatly increased effectiveness of both infantry and artillery fire, but also the rifles themselves were capable of generating sufficient firepower with less men firing over a given frontage. The British solution was to use a technique that had hitherto been reserved for skirmishing, that preliminary battle that occurred before the clash of the main body of the army. The thought was this: to use the firepower and range of the breech-loading rifle to allow for a gradual approach to the enemy while limiting the exposure of friendly forces. Rather than the old two-rank line marching into musketry range and beginning the fight, the thought was to send just a part of the unit forward to engage the enemy. This thinly spread firing line would be thickened by local supports as fire superiority was gained, which would allow for forward movement. This process would continue by the use of rushes when required, in effect a very early form of fire and movement, until the enemy was beat down enough to allow for the main body to commit and launch the assault. Indeed, quite a modern sounding concept. Now, the salient point to glean from this cursory explanation is that by default, the fighting formation was in fact a single, loosely spaced firing line of single rank, called rank entire. Behind this, at a handy, though not committed distance, were the supports. They were there to replace casualties and to thicken the firing line when required. This was followed by the reserve, or main body, which was completely uncommitted and held in a safe position. Indeed, the days of the Elma, with divisions lined up in 2 ranks at the assault, were untenable in the face of breech-loading weapons. Close order formations were still used. Indeed, these evolutions were practiced at great length and were always the start point of any maneuver or attack. Now, I might remind the viewer that this immediate discussion of tactics is very much about the army doctrine of the era, designed to fight what would today be referred to as a near-peer enemy. As many of you are no doubt aware, continued reliance on close order formations for fighting enemies of lesser technological means in the era known as savage warfare, would feature prominently as the situation dictated. Examples of fighting in both close order and extended order can be found throughout the late Victorian era, whether the enemy was well armed or not.
Defensive fighting from behind either man-made or natural cover was featured in the Field Exercise and Evolutions of Infantry. Indeed, the advantage gained from fighting behind bulletproof cover was not lost in the tactical considerations of the era. Of course, both the battles of Isla Duana and Rorke's Drift were defensive in nature. Those in command at these two battles chose significantly different tactics to deal with the defensive nature of their battles. Now, the British Army was not fighting an enemy that was armed in a similar fashion to itself in Zululand. Indeed, the Zulus did have a considerable number of firearms, but these were predominantly older types, often muzzle-loading, firing projectiles of dubious quality. Moreover, any kind of marksmanship training was next to non-existent. Infamously, the decision was made not to fortify the position at Islandwana, either by lagering the wagons or constructing other types of field fortifications such as a zareba or other entrenchments. This perhaps being to the peril of all. In an equally profound, but in this case a much more successful decision, fortifications were constructed at Wark's Drift. These were primarily made of biscuit boxes and bags of mealie. Although the materials used in the construction of these fortifications probably gave some degree of protection against the projectiles fired by the Zulu, it was as an anti-personnel barricade that they proved to be most effective.
As for firing, commonly these techniques would be used. As mentioned, the typical fire unit would be the section of some 20 men. Fire was delivered in one of two methods, volley firing or independent firing. Both these techniques could be used in either close or extended order. Volley firing, as its name suggests, was when a given group of men, typically the fire unit of a section, fired together on a specific command. Independent firing described the actions taken when each man presented independently of any other as soon as he readied his rifle. Unlike what Hollywood might have you believe, volleys were fired by the complete unit or subunit, the section, half company or company, and not by rank when in close order. Thus, typically, there would be a rolling series of smaller volleys along a given frontage. This primarily had to do with command and control considerations. It might also be interesting to know that at the time of the Zulu War, the command to fire a volley was in fact the word present. This gave a certain degree of flexibility to the individual man, which would theoretically give him the best chance to aim most effectively rather than pulling the trigger on a specific command, whether he was aimed correctly or not. Independent firing began on the word of command, commence. Beginning with the two men of the file, alternating between them for the first round, the technique thereafter allowed for every man to present at his own time after he had readied his rifle. This was the era's rapid fire. Although firing quickly was actually guarded against in the regulations, it would have been used at closer ranges or emergencies when continuous fire along the entire frontage of a unit was required. Here, using some footage from a battle reenactment done by the diehards, we can see some of these techniques in action, as it were, albeit them in a somewhat reduced scale. In the first example, we see two small sections, the left in close order and the right in extended order. The firing begins with a volley delivered by the right section in rank entire. Immediately following is a volley delivered by the left section in close order, front rank kneeling. The right section begins independent firing, while the left section comes to the present to fire another volley as the camera pans away. The second clip shows both sections engaged in independent firing. In this next clip, the section delivers a volley, while another section makes an advance in extended order.
Our boars starting to engage to their front. As I say, somewhere between 1,200 and 2,500 of them, both on the foot and on horse. And to our one side, we might not.
Here we see a withdrawal evolution followed by a volley in extended order. And finally, a section in close order firing independently.
Now, I'd be remiss if I didn't discuss one last item in the soldiers' tactical repertoire. When the enemy was able to get to within close quarters, the men had to rely on one last piece of kit. Their bayonets.
Again!
Close-quarter fighting remained a feature of late Victorian warfare, and, as soldiers had done for generations before, they relied on their bayonets. Infantry of the 1870s were instructed in the use of their bayonets through a series of structured movements known as the bayonet exercise. Here, various attacks and guards were taught to enable enemies in various dispositions to be dealt with. In its most basic form, demonstrated here, it certainly was not an eloquent set of movements, and was performed in a rather rigid style. That said, the basic skills were contained in the exercise, and these could be built upon in the gymnasium by regimental instructors to further develop the men's skills. Close-quarter fighting was never a calculated affair. Weight of numbers and aggression would usually win the day. As we shall see in the accounts of the battles we'll cover in this series, close-quarter fighting at the point of the bayonet figures in one form or another.
I hope you enjoyed this overview of the organization, maneuver, and tactics of the Army of the 1870s. As we move forward in the series, we'll have a common frame of reference as we discuss the details of the battles of Islandwana and Rorke's Drift.
Familiarity with the tactical mindset of the time will help to bring clarity to the formations used and the decisions to adopt them on the day.
As we progress through the series and approach the episode dealing with Spee and Cup, we'll perhaps take a small pause and revisit some of the themes as discussed in this video and see how things may or may not have changed in the intervening 20 years. But for now, stay tuned. An examination of the Battle of Islandwana is next in the series.
Any mention of my trip to South Africa must include A Company, 24 foot. The diehards and the queens have come together to form a most remarkable organization. If top-of-the-line Victorian military living history is your thing, then might I suggest contacting them through their respective Facebook pages.
If you'd like to support the channel, please stop by our Patreon page. The link is in the description below.
And for more information on projects and updates between videos, follow us on our Facebook page.